In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of baptism, Edward died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son, who died on the cross, was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Edward, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joys of his resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated. We now ask Sean to come forward to do the first reading.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. But the souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace. For if before men indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Be careful of this step. We now invite Kathleen to come forward for the second reading.
The second reading is from Thessalonians. Our friends, we want you to know the truth about those who have died, so that you will not be sad as are those who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will take back with Jesus those who have died believing in him. What we are teaching you now is the Lord's teaching. We who are alive on the day the Lord comes will not go ahead of those who have died. There will be the shout of command, the archangel's voice, the sound of God's trumpet, and the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Those who have died believing in Christ will rise to life first. Then we who are living at that time will be gathered up along with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. So then, encourage one another with these words. The word of the Lord.
Oh,
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. When Jesus arrived in Bethany, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, only 2 miles away, and many of the Jewish people had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I have come to believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. We come together this morning here at Queen of Angels Church, and we come together to turn to Jesus, just as Martha and Mary did in the gospel reading that we just read. It's important for us to turn to Jesus and to know that it's only through Jesus that we can truly find the strength that we need, the comfort that we need to get through a difficult time in our life. And today we come together because we have lost Ed. And that loss is very bad for us. Whenever we lose someone that we love, it's a terrible loss, and it's a pain in our heart, and it's just something that we just don't feel we're able to take. Especially when someone has been with us for so many years, and Ed has certainly been with us, and especially the type of person that he was. As we gather here today to turn to our Lord Jesus Christ and find strength and comfort in our life, we are reminded of so many good gifts that God has given to us, and so many good things that we need in our life. So as we gather here, first and foremost, we want to give thanks to God for the wonderful gift of life that was given to Ed, the wonderful gift of life that each and every one of us were able to share in. And if we reflect on that gift of life that was given to Ed, I'm sure we all have very wonderful memories, because he certainly was a person of great strength, he certainly was a person of great faith, and he certainly was a person of good cheer, or a jolly person. A little over 12 years ago, I became pastor here. And Ed and Della are the type of parishioners that a pastor is always happy to meet, most especially as he first comes here to the parish. And I can tell you that Ed and Della welcomed me very kindly and with open arms when I arrived in the parish. And then I got to know them very well over the years. But most especially, Ed was so noticeable to me, not only because of his height, because I could just look out over the crowd of parishioners and I was able to see Ed immediately, but also because of his generosity of spirit and generosity of service, always looking to help out here at Queen of Angels Church. Right away, I realized that he was willing to help out, take up the collection, always an important thing for the pastor to get done at Mass. But also, I was able to see, once Mass ended, not only did Ed come over to offer a greeting to me, but he stayed here in the church and always went up and down each pew to clean the pew of any paper that was left, or any bulletins that people read during my homily, or any tablet newspapers, or anything that anyone left behind. If somebody left a cell phone, I knew it was Ed who was going to bring it up to me and said, "Oh, look, I found a cell phone. Maybe you want to see if this belongs to someone." Always so generous, so kind, and so giving. And that's the person that I know all of you know so well. Of course, Della knows it very well. She was married to him for many, many years. How many years? 64 years. Wonderful, wonderful achievement for both of them. I know it's not easy to be married that many years, but their dedication and their love, and especially the love that I saw Ed show towards his wife, taking care of her, making sure that she had everything she needed. And so often being able to walk down 45th Street, and as I got towards the corner, especially in the nice weather, I knew that I would see them sitting there outside the building, always saying hello to everyone who passed by. So it was always a great pleasure to get to know Ed. And that's what all of you have. You have many more memories than I do. I only knew him a little bit more than 12 years. His children, his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren, all of you know him for so many years, and the many friends and neighbors who are here today, they knew Ed for so many years, and they were so attracted to his wonderful personality, his kindness, and his generosity. So we have those wonderful memories, and even though we're sad that he's no longer going to be with us, and we're sad that he went through a difficult time towards the end, we still know that he was a person of faith, and we are grateful for the gift of faith that he had. We are grateful that he was able to accept Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, and he was able to call upon his Lord to help him when he was going through challenging times like all we us are going through right now. I'm sure one of those challenging times was when Nora passed away. I know for both Ed and for Della, it certainly, and of course Nora's brothers and sisters, that was a very challenging time as well. But they remained strong. They remained strong because they were able to turn to Jesus Christ, because they had faith. They had been given that gift of faith. And Ed was given that gift of faith when he was baptized and he became a member of Jesus' kingdom here on earth, the church. And he served Jesus Christ, not only in his life of commitment to his wife and his family, but also in his life of faith, which he professed here in this very church of Queen of Angels. And we are so grateful for the many blessings which were given to Ed in his life. I'm sure when he was going through those difficult times, he called upon Jesus Christ to help him, but I'm sure he also called upon Jesus Christ when he wanted to give thanks for the gift of all of you, for the gift of his wife, his children, his family, his friends, his neighbors, all those who supported him and helped him in his life. So even though we are sad as we come to Queen of Angels Church today, we know how happy it made Ed to be in this church building. We know how happy it was for him to be able to profess his faith and to turn to our Lord Jesus Christ, just as Martha and Mary did in the gospel reading today. Jesus said to Martha and Mary, "I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe in me, you will live forever." So even though our hearts are heavy today that Ed is no longer with us, we know that he believed in Jesus Christ. So therefore, we can say with confidence that Ed is not dead. He's alive. He's alive with God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for all eternity in the heavenly kingdom that Jesus Christ prepared for each and every one of us. The heavenly kingdom that Jesus Christ prepared for Ed. And we can rejoice in the knowledge that now Ed is with all those who have gone before him, all those that he missed, who were taken from him when he was present in this world. Now he's able to rejoice with them in the heavenly kingdom, a kingdom of perfect joy, perfect peace, and perfect happiness. So our faith gives us a great deal of hope. It gives us hope in the resurrection. And we hope to be a part of that eternal kingdom one day also. We want to be with Ed again and all those who have gone before us. So that's why we make sure that our faith remains strong. Just as Ed did that in his life, we copy his gift of faith and we make our faith important and foremost in our life, so that one day we too will be able to rejoice with him and all those who are present in God's eternal kingdom. So today we come together, we give thanks to God for the wonderful gift of life that was given to Ed, that gift of life that he lived out so well in this world. We give thanks to God for the gift of life that he was able to share with each and every one of us, his family and friends. But most of all, we give thanks to God for Ed's new life, his new life in the eternal kingdom of God. Let us stand now for the prayers of the church. My brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of all those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we now join our prayers to his. In baptism, Edward received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord. Our brother Edward was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord. Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await God's kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to the Lord. Many people die by violence, war, famine, pandemic each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. We pray to the Lord. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. We pray to the Lord. The family and friends of Ed seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel any darkness and doubt that may come from grief. We pray to the Lord. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Ed. Strengthen our hope so that we may all live in the expectation of your Son's coming. We pray to the Lord. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives are purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in your kingdom. We ask these prayers through Christ our Lord. Please be seated. Thank you. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you the sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Edward, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For even though by our own fault we perish, yet by your compassion and your grace, when seized by death according to our sins, we are redeemed through Christ's great victory, and with him called back into life. And so with all the powers of heaven we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end, we acclaim. Please kneel. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Nicholas our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember your servant Ed, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. We will now have Holy Communion. As always, during this time, we ask everyone to keep social distance between the person in front of you. We will have a communion station up here in the front and another one at the break in the back of the church. We ask you to come up, receive Holy Communion in your hand, place it in your mouth immediately before you go back to your seat. Once you have received Holy Communion, we ask you to return to your seat by the side aisle. Thank you. Body of Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother Edward may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Please be seated. Now Michael will like to come forward to say a few words about his father.
Thank you all for coming this morning to celebrate my dad's passage into heaven. My dad was born in Dublin, Ireland in 1931. His mother died at a very young age, and his father sent him down to be raised at his grandfather's house in Castlebar, County Mayo. His father was an Irish policeman in Dublin for 44 years. He had one sister, Sister Mary Carmel, who's the Sisters of the Resurrection Order, and she's currently in a nursing home on the grounds of the convent in Castleton on the Hudson. He also has four stepbrothers, Tommy, Patty, Noel, and Willie, who's deceased, and Patricia, all living in Howth County, Dublin, with the exception of Patty, who lives in Canada. My dad came to America at the age of 18 and was drafted into the Korean War shortly after that. He spent a year and a half in Japan, 6 months in Korea, where he was honorably discharged. In addition to that, he served 2 years in the Army Reserves. Upon returning from Korea, he resided at his Aunt Ann Gribben's house in Woodside, 51st Street, where he met my mom, who was renting an apartment there at the time. And they started dating for a period of 3 years and were married after that. My mom was the only girlfriend my dad ever had, and they had just celebrated their 64th wedding anniversary together. And right to his last breaths, he cared so much about my mom, he could hardly talk a day or two before his death, and he was calling me, and I came over to him, and I asked him, "What's wrong, Dad?" And he says, "Did Mom have her lunch today?" And then he said something else. I said, "What was that?" It was very hard to hear him, and he said to me, "Make sure you elevate her legs, for her ankles are swelling." So that's the kind of guy he was, right? And even his love for his sister, like in the conversation with his sister, Sister Mary Carmel, and his, like in the last few days, whenever he talked to her on the phone, he'd say to her, we'll see you again soon. And I guess he meant that. So my parents, we had five children, Mary Rose, Anne, Helen, Nora's deceased, and myself. We lived in a two-bedroom apartment in Sunnyside, which my mom and dad are still occupied right to his death. The building in our early childhood days was made up of all Irish immigrants and some Irish American families as well, significant number of children. It was a very distinguishable building on the block. All the windows were green, the doors were green, and the banisters in the hallway were all green. So my father was extremely dedicated to family, church, and Irish heritage. He was by far from being a social butterfly by any means. His social network revolved around, mainly around his family and his Aunt Anne, Ellie, Margaret, and Uncle Mike, all who lived in close walking distance. And the other social network really was Queen of Angels Church. His whole life he took long walks. I ran into people, even there was like five, six people at the wake last night who told me they used to see him in all areas, whether Astoria Boulevard, Jackson Heights, Woodside. Everybody ran into him. He was constantly walking. He walked everywhere. We never had a car, no license, my mother and father, so everything was walking for him. Every year, he used to call us, had taken every one of us, we had a march with County Mayo in the St. Patrick's Day parade every year. And half the time, I would think he was either carrying two, if not three of us, up Fifth Avenue because we just couldn't make it. But he was just that kind of type. He was probably the most routine, black and white, straight-laced person you ever met in your life. He never dialed a phone or even picked up a phone when my mother was there. I would say he never told a lie in his life except one time a year, every year, if St. Patrick's Day fell on a working day, he used to pick up the phone and his words were very minimal. He'd say, "Louis, it's Ed, I'm not coming in, I'm sick." And then he'd go click. Like there was no response. He didn't wait for a response. That was just how he was. And then I guess the other thing, a quote of his, which I always remember, it's because it's kind of good to, for people to keep perspective. I guess one night, on more than one occasion, he would call, the boss would call the house and say, "Ed, somebody called out. We need you to come in." And all you would hear in the conversation, "It's my day off, not coming in. Click." And my mother would be in the background, "But Ed, we could use the money." And he'd turn around and say, "I don't want to be the richest man in Calvary." And then, so that was that. I guess, going back to the most contentious times we had as children were around the dinner table. You had to eat everything. And always you heard a lecture from, if you didn't eat your dinner, the starving children in Biafra. I had no idea, and to this day I didn't know what Biafra was. And then I guess the most contentious time is one time I got sick of hearing it. I told him, "Dad, why don't you wrap it up and send it to them?" And then he almost sent me to Biafra after that. And the other contentious time was he insisted many times all five of us kids and my mother and father had to get on our knees and say a rosary around a bed. And I would say within 10 minutes, somebody always smirked or laughed. And then he literally excommunicated me many times. And one other pet peeve of his is he always had to buy the Christmas tree and never have a car. So he used to walk about a mile down to Woodside on December 23rd, like clockwork, looking for a tree to bring home. And we'd be like, he'd be catching so much heat from us because he didn't have time to decorate and all this. And one year he left it so late, there was no trees left. He came back without a tree. So my mother found a bush that somebody's discarded or shavings of a tree, put it on the radiator, and that was our Christmas tree that year. As far as qualities go, I have to say the one outstanding quality he had, which I've never run into in my life, is that he never had a bad word to say about anybody. Like even if we were teeing off on somebody and voicing our dislike for something, he would just sit there and smile at you, but never, ever did he ever say anything bad about anybody. It was just that kind of person. And I guess in his last days, bedridden, he was constantly praying, like Father said, like constantly praying. His lips were moving in his last 2 days. And my wife in his final day, in his final hours, had said a decade of the rosary with my daughters. And he literally hadn't moved like for about an hour or two. And all of a sudden, his lips started moving. He tried to start praying, like in the end. So I guess, and one last thing to explain, when about the day before his death, I was alone with him. And he was struggling to breathe. And I asked him, I said, "Dad, you know, your health has gone downhill." I says, "Are you afraid to die?" And he looked me straight in the eye, quick answer, said, "No, I'm not." And you know why? He wouldn't be, because his whole life was here, Queen of Angels. He wanted to be here. And the saddest day of his life, when he couldn't walk down 45th to come here anymore. So when you called him on the phone, while he was coming to Queen of Angels, the only thing we ever talk about, I called him Storm Edwards. He gave you the weather report for the week. And he told you who was transferred within Queen of Angels or who was in Queen of Angels, what visiting priest was at Queen of Angels. He gave you the whole lecture. So when he started watching the Mass at St. Joseph's in Brooklyn on Sunday mornings, I got the lowdown on who St. Joseph's had and who transferred and who said the Mass at St. Joseph's. That was just like his whole life. And lastly, I'll just say, I guess anybody who went to the wake last night would probably saw a pack of gum in his jacket pocket, and people say, "What was that all about?" So my father had this weird thing about it. Up until about 3 years ago, if you went to the house, any of us went to the house, he used to give you half a piece of gum. He'd split it in half and give you one half a piece. And then about 3 years ago, we started getting a full piece. So I don't know what we did to deserve it, but we started getting it. So I guess, you know, I just want to say, "Dad, good luck. I know you're in heaven, because nobody lived a pure life to the extent that you did, as far as I know. And one last thing, if you cut your gum in half, you'll have 12 days worth of gum to eat on your way up there. So good luck and thank you."
Careful of the step. Thank you, Michael. Please stand.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Edward. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Edward in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings which you bestowed upon Ed in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet with Christ and we are with you and with our brother Edward forever. We ask this prayer through Christ our Lord. In peace now, let us take our brother Ed to his place of rest, and may the choir of angels welcome you, Ed, and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, and where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you, Ed, find eternal rest.